Hello, wishing you all a beautiful and brilliant morning. So we will continue with the chapter 6, Anatomy of Flowering Plant. In the previous session, I have taught you the differences between the early wood and the plate wood. So here, there is the differences between the heart wood and the sap wood. So let us see what are the differences between the heart wood and sap wood. So heart wood, when it is dark brown colored, and sap wood will be of light colored. And it will be forming central wood of an old stem. So central formation, that means heart means central part of the wood, that is termed as heart wood. And here, this is the outer wood of an old stem. So sap wood is an outer wood of an old stem. And here, it is heavier, that we can get here, the sap wood is lighter. It is heavier, it is hard, it is durable, resistant towards the insects. All these differences are there here in the heart wood. And here, it contains living cells. So it will be, this heart wood contains dead cells, while this contains living cells. Okay. That doesn't conduct water but provides mechanical support. They will not be conducting the water and minerals, while sap wood will be conducting waters and minerals from the root to the leaf portion. And here, this heart wood is used for the furniture making. It is of no use. Sap wood is of no use, but they will be conducting the waters to the waters and minerals to the from the root to the leaf. And here the organic compositions are being deposited in the heart wood. So hope the difference between the heart wood and sap wood, it is clear to you all. So this is of dark color and this is of light color. So just opposite of. Okay, then this will be forming the central part of the wood, this outer part of the wood. Here it will be heavier, it is lighter. It is heavier, at the same time it is hard, durable, resistant towards the insects. It is lighter. And here these are containing dead elements. Here, why? Because lignification is there. That means lignin deposit is there. Lignified cell wall you can see in the heart wood. Here in this case, you can see they contain the living cells. Sap wood contains the living cells. And here, they will not be able to conduct the waters and minerals, while sap wood will be able to conduct the waters and minerals from the root to the leaf. And here, they will be providing mechanical support and they are used to make the furniture. Not wood are used to make the furniture. Here, it is not used for such. Okay, then organic composition are deposited in it. So, the differences between the heartwood and the sapwood is clear to you all. So, moving forward. So, just now we have seen the differences between the heartwood as well as the sapwood. Now, you can see the image of the transverse section of the stem showing sapwood and heartwood. You can see here, this dark region is consisting of heartwood. Okay, this darker region, that is the heartwood, as I have told you, the center form of the wood, that is heartwood. And the outer region, the lighter region here, it forms the sapwood. Periderm is here, phloem is here, and the sapwood, phloem, periderm. You can see here, this is the transverse section of the stem joint. And as I have told you regarding the chylosis, the extension of the xylem parenchyma, this balloon-like structure. So that we will be learning later on, but just we will see the images of chylosis. Chylosis means it's a balloon-like structure. It's just an extension of the xylem parenchyma. Next, we will be learning about the core cambium. Next, we will be learning about the core cambium. So it is arrived from the meristematic tissue, secondary meristem. Otherwise, the core cambium is termed as phellogen. It is thick, it is narrow, it is rectangular in shape. And they have outer cells as well as the inner cells. Outer cells will be forming cork, otherwise it is termed as phellum. And inner cells will be forming secondary cortex, otherwise it is termed as phelloderm. So outer cells, cork, it is otherwise known as phellum. Inner cells, that it is secondary cortex, and otherwise it is termed as phelloderm. And periderm, what does it consist of? Phellogen, phellum, and phelloderm. These three comprises periderm. So periderm is in a periderm region. So what does it comprise of? It will be phellogen will be present, phellum and phelloderm. These three constitutes periderm. And cork, we have seen the bottle cork, no? so that it is impervious. Water will not move from that bottle cork. So you might have seen in the shop and all, it is being the lid is like cork cambium. Okay, like cork mark, bottle cork is of cork cambium. So how it is? This gets where it is deposited in that. Okay, so where it is deposited, that's what it is impervious to the water. So that's the bottle cork. So I have told you, you might have seen for soda and all, they keep this bottle cork. So it is impervious to the water. That means water will not move out from the bottle cork. It is super because superior deposit is present. Now let us learn about the bar. Okay, bar actually it's a non-technical term. Bar is a non-technical term. Here the bar consists of peridot. Peridot, as I have told you just now, what does peridot consist of? Hellum, halogen, phloem. These three comprises peridot. Okay, so peridot and secondary phloem and all the tissues exterior to the vascular cambium is bar. Okay, they are of soft bark and hard bark. Soft bark we call it as early bark and hard bark we call it as late bark. Now moving towards the lenticels. So what are lenticels? Lens-shaped opening, that is termed as lenticels. I will be showing you the image of the lenticels, so it will be very clear to you. So lenticels means lens-shaped opening. So what is the function of the lenticels? There will be exchange of gases. Okay, exchange of gases, that is the main function. So lenticels comprises, they will be having the complementary cells. Complementary cells will be of parenchymatous, thin-walled, round, and it will be colorless. Okay, so complementary cells, that means it is made up of parenchymatous cells, it will be thin, it will be round, and it is colorless. That much you have to understand about the complementary cells. So lenticels consist of complementary cells. So when the complementary cells ruptures, what happens? The lenticels will be formed. These complementary cells, when it is ruptured, the lenticels will be formed. Here, as I have told you, what is the main function of the lenticels? Permitting exchange of gases between the outer atmosphere and the internal tissue of the stem. So, exchange of gases between the outer atmosphere and internal tissue of the stem. That is the main function of the lenticels. So, lenticels is formed mostly in the woody trees. So, next, moving to, before that, I will be showing you the image. So, here you can see the image of the lenticels. As I have told you, lens-shaped opening. You can see here the epidermis. This is the epidermis and this is the complementary cells. As I have told you, it is parenchymatous, rounded, colorless, thin. Okay, when the complementary cells rupture, it breaks opening and lenticels are being formed. Clear? Then cork cambium is present in the either side of these lenticels. Then the secondary cortex region. This is the secondary cortex region. So, lenticels is an important diagram, children, which is asked as 3 marks question. So, lenticels, draw the diagram of a labeled diagram of the lenticels and write its function. So, just now we have learned what is the main function of the lenticels. The main function of the lenticels is exchange of gases between the outer atmosphere and the internal part of the stem. So, here you can see epidermis is there, complementary cells are there, cambium is present in the both either side and the secondary cortex. So, this region is secondary cortex. You can see here a scleral diabetes type of cells. Okay. Now let us learn the secondary growth in roots. Secondary growth in roots. So vascular cambium is completely secondary in origin. Vascular cambium is completely secondary in origin. So beginning, it will be of vascular cambium will be of wavy. That means it will not form a complete ring, wavy type of ring. Okay, then later they will be forming a circular ring. First, they will be forming a wavy ring. And afterwards, they will be forming a circular ring. So, vascular cambium occurs in the stem and roots of gymnosperms. Mainly, you have to remember this, vascular cambium occurs in the stems and roots of the gymnosperm. It doesn't occur in the monopores. That's why grafting is not possible. Okay, the monopores, cambium is not there. Okay, it doesn't occur in the monopores. So, this is the image of bark. Okay, as I have told you in the case of lenticels, no? So, from the woody stem, it is formed from the woody tree. So, here you can see here, the opening, see, lens take of opening, this rupture, you can see that the complementary cells are opened, then you can see here the bark. Okay, this is the bark. You might have seen, you might have observed over the trees at all. So coming to the concluding session of the part 5, concluding session of the part 5, the last important points that you see how to remember about the pits. Okay, pits, we have seen in the xylem, tracheids, lizards and all, no? We have seen pits. So there is a thickened area, pits are the thickened area. Depression in secondary cell wall formed only during the lignification, but not found in each and every lignified cells. Okay, these are the thickened area. So it will be depression in secondary cell wall formed only during the lignification. Okay, but not found in each and every lignified cells. So that's what pit means, thickened area. And tylose, as I have told you, that is found in the heartwood. It is the extension of xylem parenchyma. Okay, extension of xylem parenchyma. Tylose is the root-like structure. And woody dicot stem. So it is asked, often asked in the question, that how to arrange the woody dicot stem. So phellem comes the first, then the secondary cortex region, the secondary phloem. So from the center to the from the periphery to the center portion. So from the periphery to the center portion. So phellem, secondary cortex, secondary phloem, and to the root. So this chapter 6, anatomy of flowering plants, we have divided it into 5 parts, and these 5 parts I have explained it. And now the 6th part is the quick revision of this chapter, so that those who have not partaken in the 5 sessions of the classes, you will be able to follow it. Okay, so let's see the quick revision of this chapter. So we have learned that study of the structure of plant is called anatomy. So that's not that important. Just we will. So what is anatomy? We must know. No? So that's the internal structure of the plant. The internal structure sometimes may show diverse adaptations. Okay. Then we have learned about the tissues. What we have learned about the tissues, group of cells. So mainly you have to remember is that common origin. It's a common function. Then based on the capability of dividing cells, they have been divided into meristematic tissues and permanent tissues. So let us see both. So the differences between the meristematic tissues and permanent tissues we have seen in the classes. So meristos, it is derived from a Greek word. And what is the meaning of meristos? Greek, that is division. It is derived from a Greek word, and the meaning of meristos is division. Okay, so active cell division. It is not fully differentiated while the permanent tissues are being fully differentiated. So here it is undifferentiated. Okay, permanent tissues are undifferentiated. So here meristematic tissues are being divided into 3. What are they? Apical meristem, intercalary meristem, and lateral meristem. So where is this apical meristem found? In the tips of the roots and the shoots. As I have told you just now, the apical meristem, where is it found? In the root and the shoot. You can see here the image is given. Your NCERT text also it is given. The root portion, the root cap, as well as the shoot. The apical meristem is present in the shoot also. And where is this axillary bud found? Axillary bud. Where is this axillary bud found? So we can see that the shoot apical meristem. Okay, it will be occurring between the mature tissues. Okay, it will be occurring between the mature tissues. Where is it found? That is intercalary meristem. Intercalary meristem, the image of the intercalary, apical, lateral meristem I have shown you. So apical meristem and intercalary meristems are the primary meristem. Okay, apical meristems and the intercalary meristems are the primary meristem, because they will be appearing in the life of a plant and it will be contributing the formation of the primary plant body. Okay, so the next, the meristem that occurs in the mature regions of roots and shoots of many plants, that is termed as secondary or lateral meristem. Okay, that is termed as secondary or lateral meristem. So they are cylindrical meristem, otherwise they are called as cylindrical meristems. What does it comprises of? It comprises of fascicular vascular cambium, it comprises of intrafascicular vascular cambium, okay, and core cambium. These are the examples of the lateral meristem. So inter, intra, and cork cambium are the examples of the lateral meristem. So next is regarding the permanent tissues. So they are undifferentiated. They don't have the ability to divide. Okay, they don't have the ability to divide. So permanent tissues. So you can see here the permanent tissues or mature cells constitute the permanent tissues. Okay, during the formation of primary plant body, specific regions of the apical meristem will be producing dermal tissues, ground tissues, and the vascular tissues. So they will be producing dermal tissues, ground tissues, and the vascular tissues. So permanent tissues, they don't have the capacity to divide. Okay, they are similar in structure as well as similar in function. Okay, there will be different types. There will be different types. So similar in structure and similar in function, then it is simple tissues. Okay, if they are different, then it is termed as complex tissues. Next, we have learned about the simple tissues. So simple tissues means it is made only of one type of cells. Okay, it's made up of only one type of cells. So the various tissues, simple tissues that which is present in the plants are parenchyma, colenchyma, and sclerenchyma. Parenchyma, colenchyma, and the sclerenchyma. So parenchyma will be forming the major component of the organs. They are, as I have told you, they will be having intercellular spaces. Okay, we have learnt. And what is the main function of the parenchyma cells? The storage of the food. And photosynthesis also is the function of the parenchyma cells. They are closely packed. Sometimes they may be having intercellular spaces, otherwise they may be compact cells. And the main function of the parenchyma cell is that they will be performing photosynthesis at the same time they will be storage function is also there and secretion. These three are the functions of the parenchyma. Next, colenchyma. We have learned about the colenchyma. You can see here the image of parenchyma, colenchyma. So colenchyma occurs in layers. Okay, that is below, just below the epidermis of the dicotyledonous plant. You can see this colenchymatous cells. They are thickened at the corners. Why it is thickened? Because lignin deposit is there. Okay, the cellulose, hemicellulose, and pectin is being present here. So they are thickened in the area. So why it is thickened? Deposition of the cellulose, hemicellulose, and pectin. So colenchymatous may be oval, spherical. Okay, it is the shape of this one. And main function of this one is to provide the mechanical support for the plant. So the main function of the colenchyma is that to provide mechanical support to the plant. And they will not be having intercellular spaces as in the case of parenchyma. So you can see here the corners are the thickened. So because of the lignin, because of the pectin deposition, hemicellulose is present. Cellulose is being present. So because of that only the corners are the thickened. And next we have learned about the sclerenchyma. So sclerenchyma consists of a long narrow cells. You can see here the sclerenchyma consists of a long narrow cells. Okay, and they are thick and lignified walls. They are dead. Sclerenchyma cells are dead cells. Okay. They are divided into two. Fiber cells as well as sclerae. The main function of this one also to provide the mechanical support. You can see here the image of fiber. So lumen is present. Thick cell wall is being present. Lumen, thick cell wall of the sclerae. You can see here the oval shape. This is the fiber. Okay. Fibers are dead. Okay. Sclerenchyma cells are dead cells. So important thing that you have to remember in this one is that the sclerites, where is the sclerites and fibers present? Walls of nuts, pulp of fruits like guava, sapota, pear, and seed pods of legumes and leaves of the tree. So these are the important points that you have to remember here. So moving towards the complex tissues. So what is complex tissues? Complex tissues means it is made up of more than one type of cells. You can see here, it is made up of more than one type. Xylem and phloem, they constitutes of complex tissues. Xylem and phloem, they constitutes of complex tissues. So first we will learn about the xylem. What is the main function of the xylem? So for the conduction of water and minerals from the roots of the stem and to the leaves, they will be conducting waters and minerals that we have learned, the complex tissues, xylem and phloem. So first we will be learning about the xylem. So what does xylem consist of? Xylem comprises of buckets, vessels, xylem fibers, and xylem parenchyma. These are the four elements that which is present in the xylem parenchyma. Okay, so buckets, vessels, xylem fibers, and xylem parenchyma. And And here, gymnosperms will be lacking vessels in their cylinder. So, gymnosperm doesn't have the cylinder. In flowering plants, spathes and vessels are the main water transporting elements. So, these are the important points I have marked here. So, that will be how to go through. Okay. Then, the presence of the vessels is a characteristic feature of the angiosperm. If presence of vessels are there, then it is the characteristic features of the angiosperms. Then, the xylem fibers have highly thickened cell walls and obliterated central lumens. Okay, you can see here the image of xylem is given here. Okay, you can see here the elements of the xylem, tracheids and the vessels. So, tracheids, you can see here, it is being perforated. You can see here, pits are present, vessels and the tracheids. Okay, so the radial conduction of water takes place by the rail parenchymatous cells. In the xylem, the radial conduction of the water will be taking place by the rail parenchymatous cells. Okay, then the two things that you copy here, the important thing is that primary xylem is of two types. What are they? Protoxylem and metaxylem. Primary xylem is of two types. Okay, protoxylem and metaxylem. So, what is protoxylem? First form xylem is termed as protoxylem. And the, after the formation of the primary xylem, the protoxylem, then the later form xylem is termed as metaxylem. So, hope the differences between the protoxylem and the metaxylem is clear to you all. And here, in the stems, the protoxylem lies towards the center and metaxylem towards the periphery. So, that condition is termed as entarch. Okay, two types of arrangements of the xylem is there. What is that? Entarch and exarch. That you have to remember. So, when the protoxylem lies towards the center and metaxylem towards the periphery, then that condition is termed as entarch. Okay, then the protoxylem, when the protoxylem lies towards the periphery and the metaxylem towards the center, that such type of arrangement is termed as exarch. So, two types of arrangement, entarch and exarch. The entarch one, you have to remember, protoxylem will be lying towards the center. Okay, here the protoxylem towards the periphery, just opposite of it, exarch and entarch condition. So, next we will learn about the phloem. We are learning about the complex tissues, xylem and phloem. We have learned about the xylem, the elements of the xylem and the function of xylem. Now, moving towards the phloem. So, what is the main function of the phloem? Phloem will be transporting food materials from the leaves to the other parts of the plant. That is the main function of the phloem. So, what are the elements that which it consists of? Phloem is composed of sieve tube elements, companion cells, phloem parenchyma and phloem fibers. So, what are the elements? Composed of sieve tubes, you can see here, sieve tube elements are there, companion cells are there, phloem parenchyma is there and the phloem fibers. So, in gymnosperms will be having the albuminous cells and sieve cells. So, they will be lacking the sieve cells and the companion cells. Instead of that, they will be gymnosperms will be having albuminous cells. So, that you have to remember. Okay, see here the sieve tube elements in the phloem, which is arranged in the tube-like structure and it is arranged longitudinally. Okay, and it is associated with the companion cells. Then the next thing you have to remember is that the function. Okay, the function of the sieve tubes are controlled by the nucleus of companion cells. So, it is controlled by the companion cells. And the companion cells are specialized parenchymatous cells which are closely associated with the sieve tube elements. So, these companion cells are supported by the sieve tube elements. That means companion cells are special parenchymatous cells. Is closely associated with the sieve tube elements. So, sieve tube elements and the companion cells are the closely associated elements. The companion cells, what is the main function? It will be helping the maintaining the pressure gradient in the sieve tubes. So, it is being associated. It will be maintaining the pressure gradient. So, that's what it is being associated. And phloem parenchyma is absent in most of the monocotyledons. That we have to remember. In the most of the monocotyledons, this phloem parenchyma is absent. Phloem fiber that are made up of sclerenchymatous cells. Wherever this fiber is, then you have to remember that it is dead. Okay, bas sclerenchyma fiber. Okay, that is dead. Phloem fibers, bast fibers are made up of sclerenchymatous cells. And these are generally absent in the primary phloem. So, they will not be present in the primary phloem, but are found in the secondary phloem. But these phloem fibers will be found in the secondary phloem. So, phloem fibers are made up of jute, flax and hemp and used for other commercial purposes also. So, it is made up of jute, flax and hemp and it is used for other commercial purposes also. So, So the first form of the primary phloem is termed as consists of narrow. The first form of primary phloem consists of narrow sieve tubes, and it is referred as protophloem. In the case of metaxylem, we have learned the first protoxylem. The first form of xylem is termed as protoxylem, and the later form of xylem is termed as metaxylem. In the same way, the first form of phloem is termed as protophloem, and the later form of phloem is termed as metaphloem, and it is referred as metaphloem. Okay, so differences between the primary xylem, protoxylem, and the metaxylem, and the differences between the protophloem and the metaphloem. I hope the differences between these are clear to you. So you can see here the image of the phloem here. The sieve pore is there, sieve tube is there, sieve tube element. You can see here, this is a sieve tube element, this is a sieve pore. Okay, then the phloem parenchyma and the companion cells. Okay, sieve tube and the companion cells are associated, so they are maintaining the pressure gradient. Okay, this is the image of xylem, and this is the image of phloem tissue. Hope you might have understood the differences between the xylem and phloem. So here the images of xylem and phloem are there. We have learned about the complex tissues, what does it consist of, and what are the main function of xylem and phloem, we have learned. So that's all for today. In the next part, we will be continuing the revision of this, and we will be learning the tissue system.